call the meeting to order. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Katara? Where's he?
I thought he was up here.
He's here, but I don't know where he is.
Where'd he go? Oh, that's my dad. Okay.
Well, we'll do the rest of the roll call. Mr. Kraus?
Here.
Mr. McGill?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Pedicino? Mr. Palunis?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here. Let's see, there are no changes to the agenda, and the announcements are as written on the agenda. Brings us to comments from the audience, and this is comments for non-agenda items only. Any comments from the audience? Any comments from the audience? Hearing none, we'll bring it back to the dais for approval of the minutes of March 21st, 2016.
Move to approve as submitted.
Okay, is there a second? Mr. Kraus, roll call.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to Planning Commission consent, item number one.
An application was received from Mr. Wang for property for located at 33077 Springside Lane for a 24-square-foot accessory structure area variance, and the Planning Commission approved.
Okay, item number two.
Application was received for property located at Naaman at 5401 Naaman Parkway from CW NOM LLC for approval of a site plan for slope stabilization. Planning Commission recommended approval contingent upon the use of dark aggregate to blend with the natural surroundings.
Okay, item number three.
An application was received from Michael Jackson for property located at 6700 Aleshire Drive for a 16-foot rear yard setback variance, which was approved, a 10-foot outdoor recreational fireplace height variance, which was approved, swimming pool equipment location variance for pool equipment enclosure, Planning Commission approved, fence type variance for pool equipment enclosure, Planning Commission approved it contingent upon the properly maintained 100% year-round screening of the enclosure as approved by the Planning Department. And then they also approved a 1.5-foot fence height variance for the pool equipment enclosure and a 12% uniform fence opening variance for the pool equipment enclosure also.
Okay, Mr. Palunis.
I will move to approve the Planning Commission consent agenda.
Is there a second? Mrs. Meany, roll call.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to correspondence, item number four.
Correspondence was received from Daniel Marguerite to request rezoning of property located at 5910 and 5900 Harper Road, which is located at the northwest corner of Harper and Aurora Roads, from the I-2 Industrial Manufacturing to O-2 Office Park.
Okay, Mr. Palunis.
I will move to refer this to Planning Commission.
Is there a second? Okay, Mr. Katara, roll call.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, item number five.
An application for placement of farmland in an agricultural district was received from Richard Haig and H&I Ganem.
Hey, Mr. Palunis.
I'll move that we ask the clerk to schedule this for our public hearing at our next regularly scheduled meeting and also refer this to Law Department, Engineering Department, and the Planning Commission.
Is there a second?
No, Planning Department.
Oh, Planning Department?
Yeah.
Just Planning Department.
Yes. Is there a second? Mrs. Meany, roll call.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to item number six.
A request was received from Chagrin Valley Islamic Center for property located at 33725 Station Street to reconsider the temporary religious use.
Mr. McGill.
The Chagrin Valley Islamic Center has been operating under a temporary religious use permit on Station Street for the past 2 years. And this is to be renewed on an annual basis. They're requesting this be renewed for another year, and there are certain restrictions relative to parking that you must follow relative to that. So I recommend that we go ahead and approve this permit.
Is there a second? Okay, Mrs. Meany, any discussion? Mr. Katura?
In the past, I had not.
I'm Masur Malik from 7538.
Mr. Katura was talking. Once he's finished.
Religious uses are available in approximately 3/4 of our city, but not in the commercial districts. In the past 2 years, I voted to uphold the non-religious uses in the commercial district. So I will stay consistent with that vote again.
Thank you.
I was going to answer if you have any questions.
Okay, not a problem. Okay, any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
No.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Polonis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to item number 7.
An appeal was received from Edward Worm appealing the Planning Commission's denial of a lot split and various setback and not parallel to street variances for permanent parcel 95141011, located south of Woodall Road at Glenwood Avenue. This item has been tabled, and this is the third meeting.
Mr. Chair, my name is Douglas Sawyer, and I represent Mr. Worm, and we would like to withdraw our appeal of the Planning Commission denial of his variance requests.
Okay. The only thing I'd like to add for the record is that it may take 6 months from the decision below, and you may not be able to do it immediately, just as we discussed off the record, just so you're aware of that worst-case scenario. Okay?
You do. Understood. Thank you, Council.
Thank you. Drawn.
Okay, great. Thank you. It brings us to item number 8.
Ordinance number 2016-53, an ordinance authorizing the mayor to enter into a new member participation agreement with the Chagrin Valley Dispatch Council and appoint the mayor to the Chagrin Valley Dispatch Council Board of Trustees, and this is the second reading.
Okay. Last meeting, we did hear from both our police and fire chief as they made a presentation on this particular item. Before we bring it up to the dais for council's comments, I'd like to open up the floor to any comments from the audience to speak on this item. Okay, excuse me, Mr. DeCicco, the gentleman next to you, is that Mr. Tomko?
Mayor Tomko.
Mayor Tomko? Please come up to the state your name and.
My name is Bill Tomko. I'm the mayor of Chagrin Falls, and I came to share with you our experience in going with the Valley Dispatch, as well as our experience in the use of Valley Dispatch in an emergency situation. I've prepared a few brief remarks here. Chagrin was in much the same situation as Solon finds itself today. Like Solon, we had run our own dispatch center for almost 60 years. We feared the loss of control, and more importantly, we feared the loss of the local touch in our ability to offer our residents the high level of service they came to expect. Yet we needed to fund a major six-figure equipment and software upgrade at a time when the state was taking away long-time funding sources. We also needed to figure out how and where we were going to respond to House Bill 360 and its requirements to consolidate dispatch centers. We feared the loss of grant funding to defray future capital requirements and as a standalone dispatch center. After extensive searching and not without a degree of trepidation, we joined the Chagrin Valley Dispatch Center. It has worked out better than our highest expectations. We avoided the need to fund the capital costs. We found an employment home for 100% of our dispatchers, and the high service levels were maintained and, in fact, improved. We have just completed our 2016 budget, and I feel we have saved over $30,000 in operating expense. Perhaps the savings is hard to qualify, but yet real. The move of the dispatch has freed up valuable and much needed space for other police operations. Also, a benefit in my opinion is we now have a say in our own destiny. At Valley Dispatch, everyone has a vote on operations and service levels, and that may not be the case in other dispatch locations. As a regionalized center, we are in a far, far better position to qualify for grants to defray some of portion of future capital costs. Finally, I'd like to tell you how Valley Dispatch worked in an emergency. I'm sure you've all heard about the shooting tragedy we had in Chagrin Falls the other week. Valley Dispatch performed flawlessly. To invoke mutual aid, you no longer have to place multiple phone calls. Everything is automated once a box one or a box two is called in. Mutual aid is active. I arrived at the site of the shooting approximately 15 to 20 minutes after the 911 call was received. Officers from Bainbridge had already set up a traffic control perimeter. First responders from South Russell and Bainbridge were about 2 to 3 minutes behind our officers, and Chester Township followed in about 2 minutes. They had secured the crime scene and were conducting wellness checks. In these and missing children situation, a matter of minutes minutes matter for both the safety of the public and the safety of our safety forces' personal safety. We could not have gotten mutual aid to our officers as fast as Valley Dispatch Center did, and honestly, I believe this is as fast response can and will save lives in the future. Based on our actual experience, I highly recommend Valley Dispatch.
Thank you, Mayor.
If anyone has any questions tonight or subsequently, please don't hesitate to contact me, and I'll get you in contact with our chief as well.
Thank you again.
My name is Sandra Reutblatt, 34890 Solon Road, Solon, Ohio. Last week, Chief Shaw gave us a history of the current Council of Governments, COG. But remember, it involved fostering cooperation in such common services as hazmat, specialty rescue, fire investigations, bomb squad, SWAT, child abduction, etc. These things that make sense when working with surrounding communities. But you have to agree that comparing these common services with the entire dispatch organization is like comparing apples to oranges. He also mentioned mutual aid. We already call upon the communities involved in this program, but we need mutual aid. But when we need mutual aid from Aurora, Twinsburg, or Bainbridge, we call on them as well. We have and always will call on the closest community that makes sense. Regarding the COG voting rights, limiting each member community to only one vote, he said, has never been an issue in the past. But again, we were dealing with hazmat and SWAT, et cetera, not the entire dispatch center. Solon's population is nearly 25,000. We get a vote. Walton Hills has 2,000. They get a vote. Bentleyville, Woodmere, Glen Willow, and Hunting Valley have less than 1,000 in their community, and they also get an equal one vote. All this means is that the communities which have far less population will have the same voting strength as Solon, and that's just not right. There was also talk about the multiple changes to local government funds from the state, which impacted some communities' funds, resulting in those communities seeking ways to alleviate their financial burden. No one ever really laid out exactly the dollar amount of funds Solon currently receives or received that were impacted. Over the years, I have never heard that Solon was pinching pennies when it came to our community safety. Also, regarding House Bill 360, changing the taxing structure and disbursement method from the government wireless 911 fund, if and when those disbursements occur. Does Solon receive any of these monies now? And how much would Solon not receive if we declined to join this program? I cannot believe you would ever consider using Solon as a guinea pig to see if this program would benefit us. The chief stated that public safety communications is too important to experiment with, although they are looking at this program and seem willing to risk our safety if it meets three of the standards: equal or better services for the residents, equal or better services for firefighters and police, and offer a reasonable cost savings. This program laid out for you last week does not offer better services for our residents, and it actually will result in watered down of our current service level. This program does not offer better services for our fire and police, as CVD is going to provide essentially the same service that our Solon Dispatch Center already provides. I would encourage every council member to go and visit our own dispatch center and see for yourselves the nuances of our extremely valuable technology, which we just upgraded last year. Then you can really see if there is any difference to warrant changing our structure. So it does come down to cost savings. And in truth, since we are already own our technology, any cost savings will be primarily generated not by building back up our own dispatch center personnel and by severely cutting the remaining dispatcher's pay rate and by eliminating any supervisory positions altogether. There's your cost savings. Something that was never mentioned to you that was part of the that something that was never mentioned to you was that our full complement of dispatch personnel was 10 people, and 10 full-time and 4 part-timers. But that number jumped low because people jumped ship as there were rumors about this program may be implemented. To add the correct number of staff to fully handle Solon alone would mean bringing over at least 10 dispatchers. The idea that there will be less than that number of positions available for our dispatchers to be able to apply for their own job is ridiculous. And to add insult to injury, they get a pay decrease. And they don't even know which shift they're going to be working or which days they're going to be working. And this is how you compensate our highly valuable, skilled employees for a job well done. As far as technology, Mr. DeSico's own presentation admitted that CVD's EMD program, created by Mark Vetter, was created for Solon and used by Solon and then given to CVD. As far as quality assurance, Solon has basically the same technology to monitor all calls. Full service dispatch center, Solon does not have a phone answering tree. Many of Solon's current technology is housed under different names but provides the same service. And to be frank, if there's any new technology or apps available that are so valuable that Solon needs it, we should investigate how to incorporate that small piece into our already successful system. I suggest sitting down with our dispatch center and comparing our technology with Mr. DeSico's to determine if there's anything Solon's lacking. There was no mention of the logistics on 24/7 manned operator for our walk-in community. In print, it was suggested a possible secretarial staff being available. What will this person do differently than what our current dispatch center does? How equipped to handle an emergency will this person be? I see a service disruption ultimately. Also, regarding the ISO rating, the implementation of this program may or may not impact the insurance rates for businesses and has nothing to do with the citizens. And even if it guaranteed a better rating, shouldn't we look to purchase a ladder truck instead of changing our entire dispatch center? The physical property of a dispatch center in Bedford is actually in the basement of the Bedford Hospital. Has there ever been any discussion on what happens if that basement floods? And if there is enough room for 10 full-time dispatchers, not to mention four part-timers, to sit? And what is the growth build-out? Solon does not have to join the program as outlined in this plan. And although the goal is to reduce the number of PSAPs, Cuyahoga County even recognizes that not all communities will choose to consolidate, and some communities may choose to consolidate without the assistance of the county. So this join now or with similar communities or join later with communities that don't have a working relationship with us tactic is untrue. If the current available space cannot accommodate the needed square footage, then you simply look for alternatives. You really need to take Mr. DeSico's outline and compare it to what Solon currently has. Do we need an app like the app where someone has a heart attack and you need to locate the AED or have a senior citizen call 3 times a day? Then we should look into getting that app for our dispatch center. In conclusion, we are not talking about lot consolidation or locating variances for a storage building. We are talking about our own community's safety. And if we move forward with this program, we will end up with a watered down level of service I don't believe our citizens deserve. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Mary Ann Wilson, 33043 Cromwell Drive, Solon, Ohio. This project deals with public safety. Why wasn't this ever put on the ballot for the people to vote on? Our public safety is an extremely important part of living in this community. That's why people live here. Since this is such a critical safety concern, are there other cities that have adopted this plan that are not happy about the consolidation? Has anyone reached out to them or to the dispatchers and asked them how the program is working? This program just brought in Euclid, April 2015, whose population is nearly 50,000, which more than doubles the population of Solon. We don't even have a full year of statistics and data to go on before Solon is going to leap into this program. I have many friends and family in many surrounding communities. And the word on the street is they are not happy with this program, and now they're stuck and not go back to the better safety operation. Mr. DeCicco mentioned the new CVD had a 60-second call response time. What is Solon's current response time? How exactly will this new program increase that response time? It does the same thing. We currently have excellent service. How can we believe we'll get better than excellent? Why are we gambling with our safety? It's ironic that even Chief Shaw said that public safety is too important to experiment with, and he is still willing to gamble on our safety. Why are they working so hard to put our own Solon dispatchers into a lower pay capacity or eliminating their job altogether? This is from where the real cost saving is, eliminating jobs and lowering pay rate. And in return, we get a watered down version of our very vital services. This program deals with cooperation in all areas of municipal services. Is our council going to be voting next to consolidate our police department or our fire department? When will it end? From what I am hearing, Solon would be getting from this program in return for our excellent services a watered down version. You're willing to put our current excellent safety services down to the lowest level of the common denominator. Solon loses, period.
Mr. DeCicco, your name's been mentioned several times. Would you like to come up and respond to some of the statements made?
Nick DeCicco, Elmwood Drive, Solon. I think everybody here has been down to our center, and I think you can see from the technology, it's second to none. The two national awards are, again, nobody in the state of Ohio has achieved that. Nowhere around the last 20 years, that at least I've been in public safety. All the apps, yes, they're fantastic apps. It helps response time. The talk to tone, they're all very simple reports that you can run through the CAD system, and it's a standard now. Do I know what Solon's talk to tone are currently? No. But again, I'm here to answer any questions and, you know, provide additional tours if needed.
I'm being put on the spot right now. My name is Lisa Davitt. I'm from Bedford. I'm actually one of the supervisors at Chagrin Valley Dispatch. I actually started in Gates Mills before we consolidated over. I was offered a job, and I would not go back on that for anything in the whole world. Gates Mills is very resident-oriented. We've done everything from helping people get birds out of their house to bringing in their garbage to going and checking, make sure someone's curling iron is turned off. So, and we still do that now at Chagrin Valley Dispatch. We will do whatever the residents want us to do. And in your response about asking the dispatchers, I love it. Another one of my supervisors is here. She loves it as well. So I invite anybody to come ask any of the dispatchers anything, ask the officers. I wouldn't want to work anywhere else. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Any other comments from the audience? Okay, seeing that there aren't any, we'll bring it up to the dais. And Mr. Palunas, you can start.
I started this whole procedure by taking a tour of the dispatch center, and I don't really have any. I leave it to the experts with the dispatch center on the electronics and everything else. My own personal level of experience is looking at the budget and looking at all the other documents and everything else. I understand the services that it offers. I understand the statistics and everything else. I have a lot of concerns with this whole process because of the cost effectiveness of this long term. When you look at a lot of what happened, I requested hundreds and hundreds of pages of documents, and everything that comes to the board for the policy committee meeting and the dispatch committee meetings, everything that comes to the board is unanimously approved, basically, with the exception of, I think I found one instance where something was not unanimously approved by the board. It was not vetted, nothing was discussed. Expenditures just went on, and it didn't even look like on some cases they got a proper amount of bids. When you look at the when you look at the items, first item I'd like to discuss is on March 25th, 2015. Bids were received for payroll. Rita's bid was $22,200. They ended up paying $26,000. The other bids were, this is for a year, the other bids were $5,300 and $3,700, I believe. And I was told at the beginning there was not going to be a finance director hired. Then there was a finance director hired. It was told that, and I have it in writing, I was told that everyone is going to be on a volunteer basis from the municipalities, and I believe Chagrin Falls finance director was the person who was in charge. All of a sudden, then, a couple weeks later, I get a note that through my records request, my public records request, I get a document that someone from Brecksville was hired. Their finance director was hired for $9,000 a year. Then I now see that there's a posting for systems and networks administrator for the Council of Government at the salary of range of $52,000 to $93,600. And that is going forward, apparently, and that has been posted by the Council of Governments. The answers I got to some of the questions were when I was talking about the issues with the Council of Government structure, and I had some questions about, from the minutes, there seems to be absolutely no discussion or debate on any expenditures, and everything was unanimous except for one vote. Answer I got was, we run a smooth operation, and then there were some other things in there. Euclid was okay with it, and they contribute almost $1 million per year. I didn't find that to be an acceptable answer. And then I had noted at the beginning when the Chagrin Falls finance director was not compensated, but then I got a document here. It says when Chagrin Falls was doing the work, their finance director was getting paid by the COG as well. We just changed people. And I just have a lot of issues with the way this is run, and I have a lot of issues with the lack of minutes. I have issues with the law director pay. From my calculations, a law director last year for the Council of Governments for just this group made approximately $55,000, and I found that to be very excessive, especially given the fact that a starting Cuyahoga County prosecutor working full-time makes less money than that, and this is just working for a Council of Governments, and their meetings seem to last about an hour, hour and 15 minutes, most of them. And this one started at 12:32, it ended at 1:55, so they're not real long meetings. And the minutes are, if you look at the minutes, they're page and maybe a quarter, so it's not really much being discussed at these meetings. I think that the organizational structure, I did have some back and forth conversation with members of council here. The organizational structure is that each community gets one vote, so we'd be one vote out of 12 communities. So we would be generating a majority of the, us in Euclid basically, be generating a majority of the money that's going into this Council of Governments, and we don't have enough say over the expenditures of this Council of Governments. Ohio Revised Code, I forward everyone on council, the Ohio Revised Code, which does state that when a Council of Governments is formed, you can change the participation level as well as the amount of votes that you do get. It is not, as one council person said, one person, one vote, just like when you go to vote for president. It doesn't have to be that way, and it's not that way. You can always change that. I think that if we were going to do this, I think the best way to go about doing this would be to slow it down, look at all different alternatives where we'd have a greater vote, greater participation in the process, and not rush and say, if we're not in this, we're going to be stuck with someone else. I don't think that's really a fair way to go about doing it. I think what we should do is hold off right now, stay with our current operation, look at all the different alternatives. And I understand people who work there are happy, and I'm happy you like your job. I understand that there's family members of dispatchers who are here, and I'm not really taking all of that into account. What I'm taking into account is what's in the best interest of the city of Solon. And I think the best interest of the city of Solon is to look at long-term at our tax dollars. If we want to keep our dispatch center open, we have the money to keep it open. We should look for an alternative where we have a voice in making sure it's the most cost-effective operation for the taxpayers of the city of Solon.
Nancy, did you have any?
Well, I guess, appreciating what Councilman Plunis is saying. I guess my question is to both the chiefs. I mean, my understanding, you've been looking into this for not just recently, for quite a few years. If, as Bob brought up, you know, the one vote situation, to get that, I mean, would we have to spend more money? You know, if I end up getting, you know, if I want, you know, to have, you know, 25% of the control, I mean, would we have to pay for that, or have you looked into other COGS where that has been brought up?
Thank you, Mrs. Meany. It's not a matter of what you can do, because you can negotiate anything at the beginning of a COG. It's a matter of whether or not there is a COG to join and negotiate those items with. And at the present time, neither myself nor Chief Shaw are aware of any other councils of government proposals that we have an ability to even investigate joining. They don't exist at this time. So to clarify, Mr. Plunis is correct. If in fact there was another COG to join, at this point in time, there aren't.
There aren't any other ones that are out there or come to the level that I know both of you didn't even look into some because you felt that it wasn't. And I guess another question I have, just, you know, the understanding of the pay and what this is going to cost. You know, we just went through the budget, so I have a little idea of what it costs the city for the dispatch, and that's probably a little under $1 million. Looking at what this would cost if we joined the Chagrin Valley Dispatch Center, I'm seeing that being at about 800,000. Is those numbers?
I apologize, Mr. Meany. I gave you incorrect information by phone. The known numbers that we know for 2016 going into 2007 is it cost the city of Solon just over $1,189,000 for operations. And as proposed by the CVD proposal, that cost would be $1,082,000. That includes the capital expenditure that we would be making to join, which would be a one-time fee. Right. So even with a one-time capital investment fee, there is over $100,000 worth of savings based on the numbers that we know about for 2016.
Okay. And have you talked to other communities that have been in this for a while to see how much it has gone up since they've joined? I mean, how you know, when you joined in, you know, 2014, I mean, what have you gotten that information, or is anybody disclosed to you?
I have not.
I believe that was provided in the information sent by Mr. DeSico of any increases that occurred since their opening.
Right, okay. And I guess another question, because this has been asked to me by some citizens, is the board being paid? Do the people?
No, the board is made up of one representative, usually the mayor of each community, and that is part of their mayoral duties.
Okay.
Mrs. Meany, this is where what Mr. Plunis says has some credence. When you answer the question succinctly like that, we are leaving out the fact that the treasurer is a paid position. According to the bylaws, the treasurer is a board member. However, traditionally, he doesn't have a vote, and he's not considered part of the board. So I think some of the information that Mr. Plunis has difficulties with is a result of the miscommunications, perhaps on my part, over that original information.
Right. Mr. DeSico, you had some comments, I think. Then we'll.
Chief Shaw hit the nail on the head. I think there's been some miscommunication. So the board members are all the mayors. Every mayor has one vote. They are not compensated. The finance director initially was Mr. Dave Bloom from the Village of Chagrin Falls. He was being compensated by the COG for that. The same amount of money that we're compensating now, the Brecksville finance director. It's a part-time position. They were always compensated. It was never free. Nothing's changed there. And again, they have no vote, but they're considered, they're on the board. They attend the meetings to give the financial reports. Our IT, that is going forward. We just entered into a partnership with Cuyahoga County. CCOMS is now at our location. We now have over 22 dispatch positions, and I just can't keep up doing both jobs. So we have to bring on a IT consultant that's gonna help me with the network. We have one of the most robust networks in Northern Ohio. Again, anybody can come down and take a look at the IT rooms. You're gonna see exactly what we have. I can't do it by myself anymore. And everything is vetted out, and I did resend you the minutes of our ad hoc committee. So it's close to impossible to have 13 different mayors sitting in and vetting everything out. So we have a smaller committee made up of four people who vet everything out. There are plenty of disagreements. There are plenty of going back and forth with everybody for more information that they require of me. And then when it goes to the full board of the mayors, we make a recommendation as that ad hoc committee, and that's what they take us doing our work, similar to what the safety committee, planning commissioning does here in Solon. They do all the work for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Nancy?
Nick, real quick, just so I get this straight, is the finance director and the treasurer the
same position?
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. I would say that if we're going to make comments about particular operations, we should have Nick up here to answer them. I don't think it's fair to make assertions and then he not have an opportunity to respond to some of the things we're saying. So, Doug, your turn.
Chief Violent, I apologize, sir, but since I can't see you over there, would you mind standing by the podium so I can see you while I'm talking to you?
My safety net will be.
I see that. Chief, how long have you been working for the Solon Police Department?
I believe this is 32 years this year.
That's pretty impressive. And by the way, congratulations that you were just named by the governor to serve on the Ohio Organized Crime Investigations Commission.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
That's a pretty high honor. Interestingly enough, I did call most of the chiefs of the other communities that belong to the CVD. And to a man, they praised you and the Solon Police Department. I thought I'd pass that on to you.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
And in addition, they were all happy with the performance of the CVD. They were happy with the cost savings that they received, and they were comfortable with the service. Does that match your discussions with them? Have you heard anything from any of the other chiefs?
Your description of conversations parallels every conversation I've had with not only member chiefs, but also members of specialty teams who use Chagrin Valley Dispatch. Yes, sir.
Now, the dispatch center we have today reports directly to you, does it not?
That is correct.
Okay. If the governor's commission asks you to go to another state and evaluate a dispatch center somewhere else, would you feel competent to do that?
I would feel competent to participate in a review. I don't know that I would feel competent to testify in any specifics. But absolutely.
So there's a certain level of expertise in managing the dispatch center that you bring to your evaluation of CVD?
I would believe so, yes, sir.
Okay. And one of the things you explained to us was that you had looked at a number of alternatives over the past 5 years and didn't see anything that matched this. Is that correct?
That is correct. As a matter of fact, and I'll give Chief Shaw equal credit on this, there are a number of situations where we were provided with project proposals that we rejected either out of hand mm-hmm. or with some research, and those proposals never rose even to the level of committee review because we assessed them and determined that they weren't acceptable.
So this is the first proposal that you feel comfortable with all your years of service in the city of Solon proposing to council that it would suit our needs?
This is the first proposal that I am comfortable having come in public before this body and making that recommendation, yes.
Now, how long have you been in discussion with Mr. Cacico relative to this center?
We have had three separate conversations or negotiations with the Chagrin Valley Dispatch. One, the first one happened before they moved to Bedford, when they were still located at Chagrin Village.
When was that?
2011.
Okay.
The second one was they had reached out to us in end of 2014, beginning of 2015. They had made some changes, and we reassessed the economic value in comparison to the changes that they had made, and we determined that they had still not reached our level of expectations of quality of service. And then the third time is this most recent time, which is the end of last calendar year, moving into this year with the current proposal you have in front of you.
So it's a period of time. It's not something recent.
That's correct, and I believe there was as one of the things that we've investigated, we actually looked at building a regional dispatch center in Solon mm-hmm. on two different occasions. One of those required us to actually hire a consultant to do a floor plan and a build-out projected costs. And at that time, I believe it was middle of 2013, Chief Shaw and myself presented a memo to the Safety Committee that basically outlined everything that you've heard over the last month or so, almost 3 years ago now.
Okay. As a police chief, what would you fear by having your dispatch center move somewhere else?
I would fear that the calls would fail and that we wouldn't be able to have the information to get people the help that they needed.
That's your biggest concern?
That's my biggest concern.
And how do you feel Chagrin Valley Dispatch meets that concern?
I think that they currently have the technology to do that better than we do, and that's my feeling, but it's also borne out in the fact that there have been two failures with AT&T and wireless calling in the northeastern Ohio Cuyahoga County region over the last several months, where certain places didn't have 911 access at all for several hours, including the city of Cleveland. And during those events, the redundancy issues that CBD has put into place made sure that they were up and running 24/7 without an interruption.
Okay, if we decide to move forward with this, who's going to manage issues, ensure that things are resolved, and handles after action reporting to council?
At this point, the way that it works is that the management will be through Chagrin Valley Dispatch and Mr. DeSico. Mm-hmm. However, we will have representation on a users committee for day-to-day operations, as well as quality control and quality assurance that Chief Shaw currently does with my dispatchers and that we would be doing with the Valley Dispatch.
And they would be reporting back to us?
Every call that happens, we would review in-house in the city of Solon.
Nick talked, or I think you said the $1,189,000 is what we spend today.
That is correct.
Dispatch center. And even with the capital investment, we'd spend $1,082,000. What's the capital investment portion of that?
If you don't mind if I fall back a second, sir.
Well, there's a reason you brought it. I'm glad that we can provide you an opportunity to use it.
The first year capital expenditure investment would be $212,000, just over, but as I said at a previous meeting, we will be receiving $150,000 credit in that first year to offset that. Okay. So roughly the first year capital investment would be $62,000.
Okay, savings first year looks to be approximately $107,000.
That is correct.
Savings second year.
Saving second year will be slightly less because there is a second year of the capital buy-in and the credit does not apply in the second year.
Second year capital buy-in would be what?
The same. It's
okay,
split in half. $212,000. But the $150,000 credit's not there.
Okay.
So the net, there will still be a net savings to the city. It will just be less, roughly $88,000.
Okay, third year savings.
Third-year savings, there's no more capital investment, and at this point in time, our projected third-year savings is close to $300,000. Mm-hmm. Again, that's a projection, and I think that's a very, I think that's a very conservative estimate of projected savings. However, as Mr. Katora has said in the past, I don't know that forecasting beyond that is much more than a crystal ball, so I think
most corporations do 3 to 5 years for capital investment. Who would be responsible for reporting to council on those cost savings, the actual expenditures and the actual cost returns?
That would be either myself or Chief Shaw, but I would certainly do that for you through the Safety and Public Properties Committee. I do that currently for our jail operations and the revenue streams that we have for jail services that we contract out for, as well as some other things.
Okay. What would prevent any of those savings from occurring?
For the first 2 to 3 years, nothing. Those are known numbers. As we project out into the future, the unknowns might have some effect, and that would be things that we wouldn't have control over, such as healthcare costs, and things that may have to be absorbed by the COG moving into the future.
So you're comfortable with the numbers that Mr. Cacico has given you relative to his costs? You don't expect his costs to Solon to change in that period of time?
Based on the information that he's given me over his last 2 years of operations and the savings that his individual communities have already seen their costs go down, I'm very comfortable with that, at least at the inception for the first 3 to 5 years, yes.
Did we receive any state funding for our dispatch center today?
We received $0.
We do not.
From wireless 911 funds.
So from wireless 911 funds, those monies have not been distributed yet to any PSAP?
Not in Cuyahoga County, no.
Okay, and they're talking about having those funds distributed when?
Within 3 years. Yeah, within 3 years, we believe.
Any guess as to what the amount would be?
I don't know that. I would tell you that there are millions of dollars being collected and escrowed. I do not know what the distribution would end up being, but it is a significant.
This is government. They always keep a portion.
It's a significant amount of money.
Okay. All right. So we wouldn't expect to see that in 3 years, but that could affect our cost savings?
Not only could it, it absolutely would. It's part of the COG agreement. If there's a distribution to the COG of any 911 wireless funding at all, that cost, the cost of all of the members of the COG will decrease proportionally.
So that's our expectation. You firmly believe that?
That is my expectation at this
time.
And
we would not see any of that savings if we did not join this organization.
There will be zero funds distributed to us in perpetuity based on the way the current Ohio Revised Code statutory limits exist.
So there's not only would it cost us, you said $300,000 to $500,000 to upgrade our current center to match what CVD has?
To get equivalent levels of redundancy in service, yes.
Okay. So there would be a delta, a big difference between what our cost would be and what the savings would be over time. We would continue to see increased costs with no amelioration of those costs from other funds.
That is correct.
Okay.
And prior to your appearance on council at the last budget hearings, I had put council on notice that we are looking, if we stay where we are, we have an outmoded computer aided dispatch and records management system in place, and there is going to, at least as we move into 2017, need to be a significant capital investment made in software. Just to catch, right now we're working on 1997 based software. We might as well have Microsoft 3.0.
So your release or two behind, huh?
Yeah, there are some costs that this change would actually prevent us from having to make.
How do we measure dispatch center performance today?
I'm embarrassed to tell you that our software does not allow us to give some of the times that have been talked about a little bit earlier tonight, and we don't have the ability to do talk to tone time and things like that because we don't have that technology at this time.
So if we mandated key performance indicators for the dispatch center, you would be unable to do that today?
Certain ones I am absolutely unable to do.
Okay. Is CVD capable of doing that?
To my understanding, not only are they capable of doing things in terms of performance indicators, they also have the ability to look at quality control issues to the detail of they can see what was on a dispatcher's visual screen at certain times. So it's not only a matter of just call recordings and key logging, they actually have pictures of what's currently on their screens so that when you're looking at quality control, you can actually see exactly what a dispatcher was seeing at the time.
Significantly better than what we can provide.
Significantly better, yes, sir.
All right. Well, how do we handle overflow today? If we get more calls than dispatch center can handle, what happens?
There's different types of overflow. So if we just get really busy because people are calling because they want to know what time the fireworks are, people start to get put on hold. That's the type of thing that we do now. If we have a situation where a 911 line goes down and is no longer functional, which happens on occasion, our redundancy and our backup is that Chagrin Valley Dispatch is our rollover for non-functional 911.
So they're already handling some.
They handle, if we have a planned outage or if we have an unplanned outage, they are part of our continuity of operations plan currently.
Okay. All right. One of the things that could I talk, ask Nick a couple questions for a minute? Thanks, Chief. I'm okay. Am I okay, Bill?
Yeah.
Thank you. Nick, one of the things that we talked about is Red Alert program. Can you please describe that again for me?
The code red is a reverse 911.
Thank you. Yeah, sorry.
Reverse 911 system where you can send out notifications to your residents via everybody in the city or based on a geographical location. If there's a chemical spill or a business fire, you can just target a certain area.
And that's something that Solon can't do today?
I don't believe so.
Okay. What about seniors?
Seniors, we have a senior system that's a part of the code red where we leave it up to the individual resident. They don't have to be a senior. They can just be somebody that's at home that has needs. And if they want a phone call every Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 9 a.m., 12 noon, and 5 p.m., the system will be automated and we'll be able to make those phone calls. The residents have the option to pick who they want to be notified if they need assistance. So it can pick their first daughter, first, second daughter, son, cousin, and then we're the fifth in line for emergency notification. Or if they have nobody in the area, we can be the first line of notification. And our policy is if we have a no answer, we automatically send police and the ambulance.
So that would be something that is an improvement in service over what we have today.
Yes, sir.
What do you foresee in the future, additional things that would benefit our seniors?
You see, seniors are, it's a growing age right now, obviously, but we can do a multitude of things.
How do you measure performance today, Segrin Valley Dispatch Center?
So I personally listen to every single 911 call.
How do you report to the communities your performance?
They get a written report.
And what does that show?
It'll show them what our talk to tone time is, if there are any deficiencies, and if there are deficiencies, what we did to correct them.
Okay. Do you have an overflow problem? Have you had an overflow problem yet?
No, sir.
Not yet. All right. One of the other things you talked about was, I wrote down GPS tagging, but there are GPS units in all the police cars and the member communities of Chagrin Valley Dispatch.
Did yes, sir. Police cars, fire trucks, and ambulances.
Okay. So that would be something that we don't have today as well.
That's correct.
Okay. And what's the benefit of that?
It lets us send the most appropriate, closest unit to the call instead of toning out a second station or a mutual aid agency. So if somebody's coming back, I'll use Orange Village as an example. If they're on their way back from Hillcrest for a squad run and we have another squad run that's nearby, instead of calling Solon or Chagrin Falls Mutual Aid, we know that squad's on its way back and we can automatically deploy them.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. Katura?
Wow. You're welcome.
Yeah. Thank you. I think the questions that I had this evening were going to center around something that was, both things were touched on by Mr. McGill. One of them was going to be the overflow contingency for the Chagrin Valley Dispatch Center. Is there one, would that be the county at that point? That would be one question. The other question I had centered around potential cost savings in the future from the being able to receive the 911 dollars that are being collected on all the cell phone bills. So my question is, with respect to that, is it clear that every county is going to have to get down to four PSAPs prior to the distribution of any of that funding, or will it be just to the top four largest PSAPs in the county?
Thank you, Councilman. Understand that Cuyahoga County is unique in that most other counties in the state of Ohio already are only at that four PSAP limit, and they are distributing funds and have been for years. Cuyahoga County is very unique in that we don't follow the statutory scheme, and therefore there have been no distributions. It's just a different it's a different animal. The county has looked at those funds in a different way, and they have not done what the laws required them to do for almost a decade.
So the county is receiving the funds, but under Ohio Revised Code, they're not able to distribute them?
That is my understanding, yes, sir.
did the county use the funds, did the county use 911 funds to, for the build out of the wireless 911 that is going in also in the basement of the Bedford Hospital building?
I don't believe so. The last time that I know that there was a distribution, the distribution was used to fund a equipment purchase for the entire county, and that is the equipment that we received last year and had installed in our dispatch center. That was the last disbursement, and it was a disbursement by purchase. It wasn't a disbursement of funds. A disbursement of funds, if and when it does occur, will be able to be used for any costs, including personnel and payroll, et cetera. It won't just be an equipment grant.
So as it stands now, it's not clear whether or not a distribution will ever occur if Cuyahoga County doesn't. I think we're currently at 33 PSAPs or thereabouts. So if the consolidation doesn't happen to the point of getting to four, there's no clear answer as to whether or not those funds will ever get distributed.
I apologize. I can't speak for what the county's going to do with the funding. I would hesitate to guess.
But I guess maybe my point is there's no indication though that they'll want to just give it to the top four largest PSAPs.
Giving it to the four PSAPs is the statutory scheme. That is what the Ohio Revised Code mandates. I can't speak to what they're actually going to do, but that is the law, is that the disbursement will be to the top four in the county.
Okay. So a disbursement might potentially be able to take place even if Cuyahoga County doesn't get the number down to four. It's potential that the top four could get it.
That's correct. And there are several other counties in Ohio that have more than four, but the disbursement just goes to the top four.
Thank you. That helps clear that up a little bit. I think Cuyahoga County's probably put it a little bit of a disadvantage with that particular law, seeing as that we have as many communities that we do have and as densely populated as the county is as well. So then I guess the natural next progression of the question would be, if Solon were to join the CVD, would CVD then be one of the top four?
Based on the numbers that we've shown, and I defer to Mr. DeSico for confirmation, but based on the call volume numbers that we've seen, if we participated in the CVD, it would very much cement us in that fourth position, yes.
So then there may be a potential down the road to help offset our costs in the future if that were to happen.
If the statutory scheme is followed, that's how it is supposed to work. Yes, sir.
Okay. And if Mr. DeSico could maybe answer some of the overflow contingencies that are in place for the CVD.
Sure. So Cuyahoga County has just awarded the City of Cleveland. That's the first. City of Cleveland is now answering their own wireless 911 calls, and they are being paid out of the wireless 911 fund. That state law allows you to have the large city, anything over 175,000. So obviously the City of Cleveland is the only one in Cuyahoga County that meets that criteria, and this year they are now receiving wireless 911 funds. As far as overflow right now, our 911s right now will overflow to Solon. We work together as far as that goes. We would have to split our staff in half. Some would go to the City of Beechwood and some would go over to the neighboring SECC Regional Dispatch Center. The Edge Group is going to be constructing a new regional dispatch center as well. And we're going to have MOUs in place that will be our main backup. It'll be big enough where our entire staff can evacuate and go there.
So where would it go?
It's the Edge Communities. It's going to be in South Euclid.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's it. Mr. McGill, you didn't leave me many questions. You asked a lot of the same questions I was going to. That's okay. Chiefs? What would you consider the main responsibility that you have to the residents and businesses in Solon?
The simple answer is to keep them safe, provide a high level of safety. I think a little lesser known responsibility of the police chief and myself is to manage the risk of the community. We look at trends in our respective fields, sociological trends, demographics, economic trends, and those, that type of information, and manage the known risks that the community faces and try to, as best we can, predict the unknown risks. That's where it gets a little more interesting, because obviously it's a prediction, and we're using, you know, our best efforts to try to forecast what can happen in the future.
Chief Island?
I think Chief Shaw did an excellent job of summarizing.
What would we be able to do if we went to CVD that we're not able to do today?
When we talk about service improvements, and this is and has been difficult for both Chief Island and myself, we have very good dispatchers. I don't believe they have as good a tools available to them to take them to the next level to be better dispatchers. That's what we get from Chagrin Valley. So with those tools and our personnel, I believe we would be able to have a reduction in call processing time, a reduction in the time it takes to get the call to the necessary units, which in turn reduces our response time. Some of the benefits that we've heard from the seniors. Just the ability to have information available to first responders through some of their programs that we don't have now. All these little things add up to what we've somewhat generalized as improvements in service. But for the most part, it's the time factor. You know, whether it's a citizen on a 911 call who's looking for assistance immediately, whether it's a police officer or a firefighter requesting assistance for a situation they're in, we see where those processes, based on the number of personnel and the tools that, that those personnel have available to them, will be done quicker, which results in reduced response times, which equates to an improved level of service.
I would just add, Mr. Chairman, that one of the things that we look at that becomes available has to do with the safety of our employees. And there are certain things that would be available, for example, automatic vehicle location, where we are able to pinpoint where our police cruisers are, and some of our report writing that would be able to happen in a police cruiser that would allow an officer to not have his attention focused on a notebook. Both of those things would be directly connected to what I perceive as the secondary safety here, and that's the safety of our own employees. So I think Chief Shaw has adequately addressed safety of the public, but I wanted to say that the safety of our employees is another priority, and that's, there are things available to us that we cannot do right now.
Would our dispatch be able to compete for the same type of awards that CVD has received?
In the current state, I don't believe so. I think we would need
not having the tools.
Exactly. I think we would need some expensive, substantial upgrades, increased number of personnel, as well as technology and equipment to be in the same category and vie for that those awards and those honors.
Right. So, in other words, going to CVD would not be going to a watered-down version of what we have?
That's correct. I don't agree with that assessment.
Okay. Thank you. Could you explain why redundancy is important?
Go ahead. Well, as Chief Shaw said, one of our primary functions is to identify, prepare for, and mitigate risks. So part of our job is to always look at what's going to happen in the worst case scenario and what's going to happen when our own systems fail. So we do a lot of planning and worrying about what's going to happen when our phone lines do go down, what's those types of things. And we have seen that the redundancy, the technological redundancies that have been built into the Chagrin Valley Dispatch are at a much higher level than we have available to us now. And that would prevent us from, for example, for losing our 911 lines or losing our AT&T primary lines. And those things have happened to us in the past. Nothing is foolproof. Nothing is fail-proof. As I said, I think in response to Mr. McGill's question about rollover, we have had failures. The failures most of the time aren't even ours. They're AT&T's failures. They're a system failure. We still have to plan for those. We don't have the ability to have the triple redundancy that Chagrin Valley Dispatch does right now. We don't have the economic wherewithal or the technology to do that. So there are certain areas where I think that that redundancy is directly attributable to providing a high level of service to our businesses and our residents.
And Chief Vilen mentions the technological side from the service delivery side. I know the fire department, we have found over the years the number of simultaneous calls is been on an upward trend and continues in that direction. At some point in time, I feel that our dispatch center has the potential of being overwhelmed. We were participating in a tabletop discussion exercise with the schools recently, simulating an incident that was quite catastrophic, shall we say. And the dispatch personnel that were participating even mentioned that it would be very difficult to manage the incident with just the personnel that they had. So as those serious calls come in, or a multitude of not so serious calls, certainly a force multiplier of having more people on duty, nine or eight or nine compared to two, we're in a much better position to handle those multiple calls for service, be they police or fire or administrative, quite frankly. So anything that comes in would be able to be handled.
And Mayor, I do have a question. What are the other mayors in other communities that are not regionalized at this point? What are they doing at this point?
All the discussions are, it's been made very clear to all the mayors that you do by 2018 have to join a PSAP. Everyone else is looking to consolidate in some way. There's no city that can stand alone. This idea that a city can be an island of itself and provide all of their own dispatch is long gone. It's fiscally irresponsible. So everybody right now is so the whole idea about trying to create your own cog and have all the votes or the majority of votes, that's a dictatorship. Nobody's joining that cog. We'd be left out on our own. And people want to make their own decision and join a dispatch center that they are comfortable with, that they feel comfortable with the partners. For example, with this opportunity that we have with Nick DeSico and these other communities, are communities that I have worked with in several other COGs. Both chiefs have worked with in several other COGs. We have great working relationships with these other communities. I have a great relationship with all of these other mayors. And I appreciate Mayor Tomko coming out here. He did that on his own. I didn't ask him to come out here. He came out here because he cares that much. And so everybody is scrambling to join, to consolidate their services. So that's what you're going to see here. And I urge the council to really think deeply about this, because this was not, the comment was made about let's slow this down and take our time and think about this. We have been doing this. When you talk about collaborative efforts, you shouldn't, it's not a term you just want to throw around. It's something that must serve a functional value for the community. And that's why it took the city 5 years to finally bring something to this dais, because these two chiefs in 2011 started researching this with these dispatch centers. And they've gone through, you saw from the introductory paperwork that the chief gave you about all the different examples of how we tried to find dispatch and services and tried to build our own dispatch center. We tried to become that that cog. It didn't work out here. And the thing is they did have requirements. We went in, the three of us had meetings, and we had an understanding that we have certain requirements for our community, and we're going to make sure that we follow those requirements when we join a cog. And so for almost 5 years we were studying that. Since 2013, this council's been aware of what we've been doing. We have reported to the safety committee. It's been in your minutes. It's been in your packages. This isn't the first time council's heard about this. So, and so you knew the administration's been working on it. We just never brought anything forward because if it wasn't going to pass our muster, we weren't bringing it to you. So I don't want people thinking just because we might have only mentioned something in passing or made a few comments in 2013 and 2014 in a safety meeting that we weren't working on it. It just said nothing was good enough to bring forward to this council until until this year. And the thing is yes, Solon can afford our own dispatch right now. But if we want to remain an economically viable community and continue to provide the attractive amenities for our residents and our businesses, then we need to embrace the opportunities that come our way. And this is an opportunity that is being presented to us that I think we should take advantage of. Everything we do today not only serves our purposes for today, but it builds a strong foundation so that our city can continue to be successful in the future. It's very easy for me as a mayor to sit here and spend all the money the city has. I could give raises galore. I could give these directors whatever they want for their departments. I can spend money and not think about tomorrow. And where does that leave whoever's going to be sitting in this seat? Who does that leave the council that's going to be on this dais in the future? I'm not going to do that. That's fiscally irresponsible, and that is not what a mayor and an administration is supposed to do. I am supposed to make sure when I leave my mark on the city of Solon, I have left the city in a very comfortable and financially stable position so that future administrations can have the luxury of providing their residents these amenities and these great departments, our wonderful services that we offer today. And so you have to plan. You have to have long-term thinking. We can't be so short-sighted and think Solon's going to survive without the help of any other community, without the help of our neighbors. That's not how we survive now. You guys don't see it, but we are always working with other communities. The service department works with other communities. The engineering department does. The planning department does. You just don't see us doing that because you're legislative. That's the administrative part is up to us. Just like the administrative part of this cog is up to Nick DeSico. We don't come in to any cog trying to tell people how to run their business. But we will have a voice. You don't get to have a voice and tell Nick how to run a center when we're not a part of his cog. You have to become a part of it to then start saying, hey, okay, here's a concern of ours. You've got to remember, as legislators, we do all the background work for you. We've been doing all the research and everything. And it's really important that we trust these two gentlemen over here, Bill Shaw and Chris Vilen, are our risk managers for this city. And they are the experts in the field of safety. They know dispatch better than anybody. Anyone up here, anyone that's had experience, they are working on this every single day. They're the ones listening to calls, auditing the calls, working with the actual dispatchers, working with our boots on the ground, you call it, our firefighters who are out there every day, our police officers who are out there every day. And it's really, I really commend all the work you guys have done for this past 5 years. They did the hard, they did the homework for you. So we're coming now to you with a plan after 5 years saying, here's something we truly believe in that is the best thing for our city to do. You've got to remember, these two gentlemen aren't going to be here. For them, it would have been easy to say, you know what, Mayor, let's not touch this. Wait till we're retired in a few years to, and you guys have said that publicly, so it's okay. I'm saying that. I'm not pushing
you out.
But that's the easy thing to do. These are hard decisions. When you have controversial issues, that's tough to bring it forward. But you can't run from something because it's difficult. You have to do what's right for the city, and this is right for this city. So I know I answered a little bit more than what you asked for, but I feel very strongly. I have, as mayor, I have not lobbied this council on any issue. I always felt we have to come and we have to prove our case when we present something. And I think you gentlemen have proven that this is the right decision for this city. I truly believe that, or it wouldn't have gotten, it wouldn't have even come to this dais. And, but I am telling, I'm asking this council to really dig deep. I know it's hard, but, and I know people's lives are involved and their livelihood, but they are offered jobs. And that's important to know. They are offered jobs that they can go to. They're not being left unemployed. They are being offered positions. And maybe it's not as great as they have it, or they, that they want it, about their hours or days, but you know what? They still have employment offered. And so I understand that. That's a tough decision. And as I said, but just because it's a tough decision doesn't mean we shy away from it. So I really, I truly believe this is the right thing to do. I believe these are the communities to join. I have a lot of confidence in Nick DeSico. We have worked together on several other items. I don't know if people know. I mean, Nick is invested as well. He's a resident. He actually is a member of our JED board. He's, I think, your coach and everything too. I mean, he's invested in the community. So this isn't as if he's just trying to give a sales pitch. This is just incredibly important. And if I may, I also want to offer, I'd like to read into the record. I did receive also a letter from our county councilman, Jack Schron, and I want to share the letter that he sent, and then I will give copies to Carol so you could distribute to the council. But this is a letter from Jack Schron. Dear Mayor Drucker, I'm writing to indicate my support to the concept of Solon joining the Chagrin Valley Dispatch. As the county council representative for Solon and representative for many of the communities served by the CVD, I think that Solon would be very well served both on a professional and performance basis by joining the CVD. This dispatch center is an excellent example of how communities came together when they had a desire to solve a common problem. The CVD not only solved their dispatch needs with little outside help, they did it in a superior way. The CVD is now known to be one of the best dispatch centers in the land, using the highest quality equipment, providing terrific customer service while saving the jobs of those who wish to transition into the new CVD. Some of the benefits for Solon citizens will be a senior program, allowing for checkups of all seniors at any custom time or day, emergency medical dispatching, staying on the line with someone in need of help, never having a recorded phone tree, answering the phone, always having a human to help, monitoring all IP camera systems for city hall, parks, schools, ODOT freeway cameras, and redundancy throughout the system, redundant telephone systems, redundant radio systems, redundant internet, and redundant power. With all that is going on in the world, how reassuring would it be to have the CVD monitoring cameras in Solon schools, parks, and city hall by a real person 24/7? How reassuring to tell your seniors their personal safety devices will be monitored should they fall in a bathroom by the CVD. How reassuring to know that some of the best equipment in the industry will have backup redundancy for any unexpected occurrence. Even though the critical consideration of a move by Solon to the CVD must be based on the quality of the service and the benefits to your residents, it is also anticipated that this change will result in a $300,000 savings for the city of Solon. There will be a need to install some equipment in order to be a part of the CVD, but this need would exist if Solon were to upgrade its current facilities. From what started out as 8 communities coming together to solve a common need, the CVD has now become 13 communities strong. I believe that joining the CVD would be in the best interest of Solon's police and fire teams, your business community, and most importantly, your Solon residents. If there's anything I can do as your county representative regarding this matter, please let me know. Sincerely, Jack H. Schron, 6th District County Council. So I will give a letter as well to Ms. McConaughey. Thank you. Great.
Thank you, Mayor. I guess some of the key points that I was going to ask were answered in both the mayor's comments and some of the questions. But in looking at this, and the fact that it has been over a 5-year period of time, the fact that your responsibility is the safety of the residents and your employees. I know that this is not an easy decision, and like the mayor mentioned, you only have a few years before you retire. The easy thing would be to do nothing and to leave it to the next person. I respect your judgment and I respect your experience, and I appreciate you bringing this forward. I support this 100%, because you know, if you feel this strongly about it, that you bring this to this body with your experience and the responsibilities that you've had in Solon, I have to be for it. I do not have the experience or the expertise in police or fire to tell you how to do your jobs. And again, 100% support behind you in this. Anybody else have any comments or anything else? Mr. McGill?
Just one thing, and I promise I'll be a lot shorter than I was last time.
You're right, you will.
In doing my research, I didn't find any national governmental organization that evaluates dispatch centers. I did come across a number of organizations that do review dispatch centers, one of which is National Academy of Emergency Dispatch, International Academies of Emergency Dispatch, Commission on Accredited Law Enforcement Agencies, all do some evaluation of dispatch centers. And all of those were used in an evaluation performed by something called 911dispatchedu.org. They rated Chagrin Valley Dispatch as number 2 in the country after Clark Regional Emergency Services in Washington, state of Washington. So the first question I have is, you know, are these organizations worth paying attention to? And number 2 question is, did they provide any input into your practices and procedures that would influence the way that you manage your center? And number 3, I didn't see Solon in here anywhere. Were you guys contacted for any of these surveys?
We were not. Very quickly, just to give you some context, the CALEA, the Commission on Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies, does not only dispatch centers, but they actually do police departments and other law enforcement agencies. We are not CALEA accredited as an organization. However, we absolutely utilize their standards when we create our own policies and procedures.
Excuse me, please come up.
APCO is what's known in the dispatch world that sets policies. They vet everything out, and we do follow those. We're a member of them as well.
Okay. So they provide guidance to you in how you manage your center?
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else? Okay, then we'll
I just want to make one comment. I just really want to thank Mayor Tomko for coming. I mean, I really appreciate you coming, and also the two young ladies, the dispatchers. I think it's important that we, I mean, I've been to the center, but obviously you were busy and I didn't want to interrupt you when I was there, but you know, I appreciate that also is helpful to have people that are working there. And again, thank you, Mayor, for coming.
Thank you. All right, brings us to new item number 9.
Ordinance number 2016-69, an ordinance determining to proceed to submit to the electors of the City of Solon the question of the renewal of an existing 0.5 mil tax levy for the purpose of acquiring motorized vehicles and equipment together with the necessary appurtenances for use in the service and safety departments of the city pursuant to sections 5705.19F and 5705.191 of the Ohio Revised Code and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Krause.
Yeah, this is a renewal levy. This was discussed at our Finance Committee meeting, and it was recommended that we bring it to the council and place it on the ballot. This was originally done and approved by the electors back in 2001 for the 0.5 mil tax levy. It's used primarily for acquiring motorized vehicles and equipment for the service and safety forces. It was again approved by the city after 5 years. It was approved in November 7th of 2006. Again, a renewal levy, a 0.5 mil tax levy. And again, 5 years later thereafter, November 8th, 2011, it was approved, the 0.5 mil, with the amount of revenue
that's generated by the 0.5 mil levered renewal, assuming that the total current valuation remains the same, we will not have the necessary funds to be able to meet the needs and the specifications of for the safety equipment and the surface equipment. So this is necessary, this renewal is necessary to be placed on the ballot. It will be for an additional 5 years. So I will make that motion to place this on the ballot, this ordinance, determining and submitting it to the electors with the renewal of an existing 0.5 mil tax levy, and I would move under suspension.
Did we want to keep this on three readings on this?
We have time.
Is that there's
do you want to, if you want to, that's no problem.
Why don't we do that?
Okay, we could pass it under emergency when we pass it, but
right.
So we can speed it up in the process. But we do have time to make sure. Sure, that's fine.
Thank you. Item number 10.
Ordinance number 2016-70, and ordinance authorizing the removal of the quick curb along the curb lane of State Route 91, Somme Center Road, and to permanently close the curb lane south of the U.S. 422 eastbound exit ramp to the Bob Evans driveway as part of the Somme Center Road resurfacing project.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. This quick curb was actually installed back in 2013, and it was found to have really helped with the accidents in this area. Therefore, it's been recommended by our traffic engineer, GPD, and ODOT to remove the quick curb, as well as removing the unused pavement. And ODOT has agreed to fund the construction of this at 90%, and this will take place when the resurfacing of Route 91 takes place later this summer.
Motion.
Okay, so I'll make a motion authorizing the removal of the quick curb along the curb lane of State Route 91.
Suspension.
And under suspension.
Okay, is there a second? Okay, Mr. McGill. Okay, roll call under suspension.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Final passage.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, this brings us to the end of our agenda. Any comments from the audience? Any? Ms. Frankel, go ahead. Please come up to the dais and state your name.
Jill Frankel, Director of Senior Services. I just wanted to thank you that although you cannot all spend as much time with the seniors as Councilwoman Meany does and recently Councilman McGill, I do truly appreciate your concern. I've heard over and over tonight the word senior, 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 and it's nice to know that we're not alone in being concerned about the seniors. The city has really made a long-standing commitment to keeping seniors independent at home to assist them to do that in the community. And in light of the fact that falls are the leading cause of injury of seniors, many of those falls occur at home. Falls are also the leading cause of death for seniors. Considering moving to Chagrin Valley Dispatch really speaks to assisting the seniors and living independently. And I wanted to thank you for that. So.
Thank you. Any other comments from the audience? Yes. Please go ahead. State your name and your address, please.
Mr. Malik from 7538 and representing Chagrin Valley Islamic Center. Wanted to take a minute to thank the mayor, vice mayor, the council, and the administration and staff. You know, you guys have been very accommodating to our needs and our services and all that. So just wanted to take a minute to thank you so much. And we love being in Solon and looking forward to building our new mosque at the Liberty Road and working with the council on that also. So thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from the audience? Hearing none, we'll bring it back to the dais for comments from council, starting with Mr. Palunis.
I have no comments this evening.
Mrs. Meany?
Again, I think this has really been a good process. I mean, I appreciate the citizens who have come and spoken to us. I appreciate, like I say, the two dispatchers who came, the mayor. You know, this is, you know, like I say, this is a big thing. You know, probably one of the most important services the city provides to its citizens is is this. I mean, these are life and death situations, and I just think, you know, hearing from everybody, it's been really helpful. And again, the respect that I have for the two chiefs is you know, really high, and I appreciate certainly their feelings on this. And you know, we'll see. We'll be having a vote in 2 weeks, so we'll go from there.
Thank you, Mr. McGill.
I'd like to express our sympathy and condolences to Mayor Tomko on the events last week, and I appreciate, given the circumstances, that you took the time on your own initiative to come here and speak tonight. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank citizens for coming and expressing their opinions. We need that and appreciate it very much. Thank you. And for the supervisors at Chagrin Valley Dispatch for taking the time to come see us. Also, Chief, congratulations again on being appointed by the governor to serve on the Ohio Organized Crime Investigations Committee. I hope it doesn't take you out of our city too often and for too long. And also, I'd like to congratulate you and Mayor Drucker at Solon being ranked one of the 50 safest cities in Ohio. I think that's pretty impressive. And I'd also like to recognize Solon Schools as a former musician. Solon Schools were named as one of the 476 school districts across the nation as one of the best communities for music education. That is really cool.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Katura.
I'm starting to wonder why I moved over.
Sorry.
Yeah, I guess ditto. Obviously, with respect to Solon Schools, it's a place that's near and dear to my heart. My father was an administrator there for many years, and he started his career as a music teacher. So seeing that, I guess, was special to me. I was going to congratulate the chiefs as well. Solon was named one of the 50 safest communities to live in Ohio. I think that's something for us to be very proud of. I'd like to thank the residents as well for coming and speaking. I think it's important to also thank the residents who have been sending in email correspondence as well. And would like to thank Mayor Tomko. Really appreciate you taking the time to come this evening. And I need to apologize to my wife. I gave up our opening day tickets because of the council meeting tonight. I told her we can't go, and then they canceled the meeting and postponed it until tomorrow. So, but I'd already given the tickets away, so sorry, honey. Those are my comments for this evening.
Mr. Krause.
Hope to see everyone at the Kiwanis breakfast Sunday morning. I think it's from 8 to 12:30 at the Rec Center. And want to echo what was said about Chief Island and the appointment to the Ohio Organized Crime Investigating Commission. Our mortgage fraud task force that the chief helped put together was one of the few individuals throughout the county that not only uncovered mortgage fraud, but understood how to teach mortgage fraud and how to teach other officials in various other communities. And the chief was instrumental in helping us form one of the largest mortgage fraud task force in the country. And his appointment to this commission by the governor speaks volumes. It's a very select group of law enforcement officials throughout the state of Ohio, and they make all the critical decisions on the task forces that are run throughout the state of Ohio. So it's no small achievement being appointed to this this position, and it goes to show all of the work and the efforts and the innovation that the chief has brought to our Solon Police Department. So congratulations, Chief. That's it.
Mark, I feel your pain.
Thanks.
Your last one.
Not really.
But I think you need to take lessons from Mr. Krause. He's never at a loss for words.
But he's Irish.
But I do want to thank the residents for coming and sharing your opinions. The dispatchers, Mayor Tomko, appreciate you coming tonight. Those are my comments.
Chief, congratulations on your appointment. I know it's repetitive. They think it's all tough. I get the last one from up here, but... But congratulations.
Thank you very much.
That's it. Mr. Lobey.
No comments tonight.
Carol?
No comments.
Chief Island.
Just thank you for the comments, and I would like to throw the accolades actually back at Councilman Krause It was Councilman Kraus who was instrumental in allowing me to participate in Ohio Organized Crime Commission's Mortgage Fraud Task Force in Cuyahoga County in 2008. And I appreciate that because that's what allowed me to learn and grow and be able to do a lot of the things we've done. So thank you all very much.
Great. Chief Shaw?
Congratulations, Chris. Thank you.
Mr. Franklin?
Nothing tonight.
Mr. Bandera?
I do have two short comments. The first one is we're excited to announce that Simple Recycling will start their first collection the week of April 18th. I believe the first flyer went out to all the residents. It's a reminder flyer. The next flyer will be going out next week. That's the actual packet where you'll be getting the green recycling bags and stickers, and it'll have a lot of detailed information in that packet of acceptable items. So I do encourage residents to please take the time to read that packet. And then there'll be one final reminder going out right before the program starts. And the first collection, again, is the week of April 18th. So it'll go, you'll start participating in the program, if you wish to, on your normal collection day. Nothing changes. You just use the bag and place it out there at the curb by 7 o'clock in the morning. And the second announcement is I just want to remind residents that Earth Day is coming up April 24th. At the end of this month, we are changing Earth Day this year. It's going to be at two different locations. It will not be at the Solon Community Center. Half of it will be at the Solon Service Department at 6600 Cochran Road, and you can visit our website. There's a nice detailed flyer on the website that talks about Earth Day. We'll be doing the mulch bags at the Service Department and e-scrap. The other part of Earth Day this year, we thought it was appropriate with the water resources to incorporate our community shred along with the open house down at the water reclamation plant. So the second part of the Earth Day, we're letting them have a little bit of that to show off the plant. They're going to be doing guided tours down there. They'll have some refreshments. But if you want to participate in the community shred, you'll go down to the treatment plant. It'll be well marked. We'll have banners going up this week, and there'll be some information in the local newspapers about that. So we hope to see everybody out there. It's a bit of a change, but we're very excited about it. We think it'll work out very, very well. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Mr. Bush?
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
All right. Peggy's not here tonight. Nope. So is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Is there a second? Mr. Katora will. Okay,
second.
Roll call.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Meeting adjourned.